Ladies and gentlemen, this is an excellent opportunity to discharge some of my experience and related thinking of the last couple of years. And I'm also pleased to be able to be part of this very distinguished panel. I will try to reflect on the previous speakers, some of the points they made. And I would like to start that off with fully embracing Nancy, that is to say Nancy's proposal for a global social contract, because I think that is really a very good way to state what we need in the world going forward. So let me explain, and I'll do that from my own perspective and in my own way of reasoning, my view, and as I said, also based on what I have seen and learned during my stay at the World Bank in the last couple of years. I have learned to look at the world mainly as one interconnected and interdependent life support system. And from that perspective, it has become very clear to me anyway that this system is in fact, in many respects, out of balance. That crucial balances are disturbed, are underway of becoming so. This is quite evident for the monetary system, which has gone broke. It's as much as that. But in my view, it is only one manifestation of the crisis we are in. At the same time, we have crises on our hands with climate change, energy system, water, and also food. And maybe even beyond that, the availability of essential resources like forests, fertile land, fish stocks in the high seas, and biodiversity is declining. And all of this is primarily, and she also mentioned that, a threat to those people who used to live on only a couple of dollars a day or less. But ultimately, it will impact the quality of life, and if we don't change our ways, ultimately life itself, of all people and all living species on the planet in a negative way. The combination of 6.5 billion people and our present way of life, of producing and consuming, creates a claim on the planet's resources that is not sustainable, just not sustainable. We want and use more than is available in a sustainable way. Our ecological footprint is exceeding the sustainable so-called carrying capacity of the Earth at this point by at least 25%. In fact, looking at it from that perspective, we are consuming the future. And again, looking at it from this perspective, also shows the common background of the credit crisis and the ecological and related social crises. It is in both cases living on credit. It is borrowing from the future. And labeling it in that way, you could also say it is in fact, a cultural crisis. It is a crisis of especially our Western way of life. And looking forward, this can only get worse with 7 or 8 and possibly 9 billion people on the planet. Unless, and that's the big thing in my view, unless we change the nature and the structure of our economies. We change the way we cater for our needs. So the big challenge facing mankind in the 21st century is to develop a culture, a way of life, a way of producing and consuming that is compatible in a sustainable way with the carrying capacity of the Earth. And that represents really a big, big challenge. But also one, and that is, as far as I can see it, the good news that is already out there, that it is quite achievable. Based on all what I have seen and read and the reports of the World Bank, but also in different research results that have been published, based on all of that, I am of the opinion that the concepts and the technologies necessary, you know, to make that change are already available. We know what we have to do, and we already have the knowledge and the related technologies to do it. So what it comes down to now is creating awareness, political will, and capacity to execute what is needed. And I'm not trying to say that this is going to be easy. To the contrary, it will be an uphill battle. Not because we don't know what to do and how to do it, but it will go directly counter the vested interests in business, in people's lives, and also the interest vested in national governments. So that's going to be, especially in the Western world, the real battle, the uphill battle I'm talking about. But as I see it, there is not much of a choice. In fact, I think there is no choice. The only way to go is what I'm talking about. Anyway, that is my conviction. I'm sharing that with you. The major issue of our time, the major issues of our time are global and related to the very basis of life itself. It's life issues, life-threatening issues we are dealing with. And the only way to confront these issues effectively is by a common effort directed and coordinated at the global level. And that is why I strongly support Nancy's proposal for a global social contract. I think that's really the way to do it. That's the way we have done it at the national level. You rightly mentioned that. And we have to, we are, in fact, in Europe, we added this European level to kind of, you know, also express our desire to have a balanced society. And we now have to bring it to the global level. So in order to create and effectively execute such a global social contract, I think we urgently need an updated system of global governance. The present system dates from the post-Second World War time. It does not reflect our 21st century world and is not suited to deal with the present global issues. What is first of all needed is acceptance by nation states that dialogue and subsequent cooperation at the global level are an absolute necessity to address the issues facing us. And I think that the subsidiarity principle that guided the development of the European Union in recent years could also serve as quite well at the global level. That is, you know, delegating the issues to the next higher level we can deal with effectively at the lower level. That's the way, I think, to approach also this. We need effective global institutions to deliver global public goods, such as the eradication of poverty, monetary stability, security, sustainable use of eco-resources, a fair global trade system, and also effective health care systems for one reason, for example, to prevent pandemics. This global system that is out of balance is producing really the threat of pandemics. And some people tell us it's not, the question is not if, but when this arrives. I mean, so we really have to hurry there. The existing global governance structure and institutions are insufficient at this point and also lack legitimacy. Institutions like the IMF and the World Bank urgently need reform, if not transformation, into real 21st century institutions, reflecting 21st century realities and mandated, and that is very important, mandated to act in the interest of the world as a whole, instead of being dominated by some major shareholders and especially interests in countries of these major shareholders. My hope is that this will become possible because, first of all, of the seriousness of the issues we are dealing with, and also because of what I see as the emergence of a multipolar world power structure. So the unipolar world structure is kind of developing into a multipolar world structure, and that would mean that we really need more cooperation in order to get things done. Of course, much will depend on the approach the new US president and administration will take. My guess is that Barack Obama holds the view that cooperation on issues of common interest should be pursued, even if there is difference of opinion on other issues. So that's also the background of him saying, you know, I'm going to talk to what Mr. Bush labels as our enemies. That's his worldview. He wants to seek the common ground. That's anyway my impression after having watched him very closely during the campaign. So in my view, in the next couple of years, a window of opportunity might open up to create a global governance network. I think about it as a network of institutions that is better suited to tackle the huge challenges facing humanity in the next few decades. But of course, it remains to be seen what kind of influence the present credit crisis and recession will have on all of this. It might go both ways. I'm realistic enough to see that. It might really go both ways. It might be helpful in the sense of bringing the message home that cooperation is the only way out, but it could also be an impediment to develop the kind of cooperation that is needed. So what I discussed so far, fully in agreement with Nancy's introduction, is the need for a global social contract and a transformed global governance system. But that still leaves open how the system should operate in fostering development. So next I will share with you some more detailed thoughts and impressions about development cooperation, or as it's still called internationally, development aid. I come back to that in a moment. And here again, I'm in agreement with Nancy. the emphasis should shift from development aid as primarily unilateral charity, with the accent on charity, emphasis on charity, to the broader notion of development cooperation, seen as working together to further common interest. Common interest. This shift could also be helpful, I hope, I think, in the quite tense debate about the future of development cooperation that is going on in our country at this point. In the past, development aid has mainly been sold, between brackets, as solidarity with the poor. And there is nothing wrong with that. In itself, that is noble. But I think it will be insufficient to really tackle the world's problems, of which we, in our corner of the world, are not isolated. If the world is one interconnected and interdependent system, if we are in this boat together, it is in our own self-interest to support developing nations. It is our own interest to tackle in a common effort the huge challenges these countries are facing. And if we don't do that, we will experience the consequences in the form of scarcities, unchecked climate change, failing states and terrorism, and also migration flows. We have to, you know, give these people a reason to stay where they are, in a way. Anyway, to keep those parts of the world habitable. We have to move beyond development as charity, and beyond also the paternalism that goes with that approach. Development cooperation, in the real sense, is supporting people to develop themselves based on their preferences and fitting their specific circumstances and culture. And that sounds maybe obvious, but I have seen in the last couple of years too much of the old style, we know, and we should teach them how to do it. The so-called Washington consensus and extensive conditionality are just that, paternalism, and we tell them how to do it. Fortunately, both the Washington consensus and conditionality have eroded in the recent years, but the transformation to a well-coordinated, country-based and country-owned development model is far from completed. And in my experience, that goes back to donor countries wanting to keep waving their own flags and following national priorities they can sell to national electorates. And in an institution like the World Bank, there is a lot of resistance, both from donor countries and from staff, to decentralization of operations. And by doing that, by opposing those really needed changes and move, they oppose what Chang was talking about, differentiation and increasing the capacity of these institutions to address specific circumstances and needs. I can say I worked very hard during my tenure as an executive director, and with full support, I can tell you also that, with full support of the Dutch government, to overcome that resistance. And I can tell you we have made some progress. We are now talking in the World Bank more about not about if it has to happen, but how to do it and to what extent. So that's the progress we have made. But it remains to be seen how far ultimately this will go. It might take a far-reaching overhaul of the bank's governance system before we can turn the classic top-down development model around. And with around, I mean turn it upside down. That's really, in my view, what has to happen. What I would like to see happen in this context is the creation of a development model that combines at least three of the following features. One, a development model based on country ownership, country development programs with sufficient room for differentiation between countries. So specificity in the country programs. Then secondly, the so-called CASAS, country assistance strategies or country partnership strategies, will have to develop as a framework for a strong multilateral coordination and strengthening of the role and position of multilateral institutions. So go multilateral. That's another point I agree with Nancy. And thirdly, these programs at the national level and the support programs in multilateral institutions will have to be embedded in the global public goods approach. Because if you don't address climate change, for example, in Africa, it is, as we say in Dutch, dweilen met de kraan open. So you really have to include that into the equation, the notion of global public goods. So, and this model would probably also deal with one of the main points raised by Hayun Chang, his criticism about the neoliberal globalization, neoliberal model of globalization. And although I might not be as critical as he is about certain market-oriented policies, in my view, he really has a point in signaling the shortcomings of neoliberal market fundamentalism, especially, but not only, for developing countries. While visiting developing countries, and I got an opportunity to visit quite a few, I have come across several examples of governments rightly refusing to follow Bretton Woods advice. One was the government of Ethiopia, following a very cautious approach in developing the domestic banking sector and refusing, at least in this stage of development, to open this sector up for foreign banks. And certainly, looking back from where we are today, that was pure wisdom. The other one, Chang mentioned that also, I visited Malawi and got quite some lectures about fertilizer subsidies. But I got convinced that was a very effective measure. And they really solved a big domestic food production problem with introducing that subsidy. And I can tell you, in the meantime, the World Bank has followed suit and is now funding subsidized fertilizer programs in quite a few countries. More generally, traveling in Africa, I have met very competent people and very competent governments, knowing exactly what they want and how to develop their countries. All they need is our support. They don't need lectures and preaches from our side. And to just to illustrate the point that wisdom about what works in today's world is not our monopoly. And I'm inclined to take this point even further. The experience we gained with our development dates from the industrial age. And in my view, we are now at the point where we are moving beyond the industrial age, where we are moving towards, let's say, new principles of how to organize societies, how to organize our economies. So it becomes increasingly doubtful whether that experience will be fully relevant for the future of developing countries. We are moving from what I used to call a fossils-based economy to an economy based on what ultimately will be harvesting from natural flows. And that especially goes for energy. That's the future. So I always explain it, you know, today mankind is digging holes in the ground and digging fossils, and we burn them and work with them. And what we will have to learn to do, and the technologies are already there, is really, you know, catch from the flow. And the flow is abundant. And, you know, that's the future. And looking at it from that perspective to African countries, to the tropical areas in the world, you know, they have a lot of that. So they have huge potential in developing that kind of economies. And we don't have that experience. So I would be inclined to think that developing countries may well have an advantage here. Because, and that's another reason, they do not have an installed base of previous generation technologies, which will be kind of hampering us and putting a brake on that transition here. But they have, you know, a blank sheet in a way. So building the economies of these countries should, in my view, be based on the new generation of concepts and technologies enabling sustainable ways of production. And I see that as a huge opportunity. And the only thing is that we should refrain, you know, from telling them and telling them over again how we have done it, because that's not the reference they need. So exchanging experience and best practice in the future might well also become a two-way street, thus enhancing the notion of cooperation between equals. So then, that being said, I want to briefly comment on two points made by Hayoung. One is about the role of the state, which should get more emphasis, and the other one is about global rules, and especially that these global rules should allow for asymmetry between developing and developed countries. So first, the role of the state. In my opinion, after the recent events and the mess we are in now, market fundamentalism has, in a way, taken care of itself. So maybe that will not be the debate going forward. But even before that happened, a re-evaluation of the role of the state was underway. After studying a development experience of a whole range of countries, the so-called Growth Commission of the World Bank, created by my friend Mr. Wolfowitz, drew the conclusion that strong government institutions and regulation are crucial, really crucial ingredients of successful development. And that was, let's say, market-oriented economists making that research, doing that research and making that report. In my view, intelligent combinations of market systems and government intervention will make the future. And the mix of the two will depend on the specific circumstances and the stage of development and of local preferences. I think that's the coordinates of that developing approach. And I don't see that as a choice between capitalism and socialism. That's not the issue. The issue is to find a way forward that is transcending this division. And we could do that by developing different blends in which the creativity and entrepreneurship of individuals is employed to its fullest extent, because that's an absolute necessary ingredient, and also, let's say, illustrates the need for continued market-based policies. But at the other hand, also be directed, and hopefully by what I call intelligent regulation, be directed at working for the common good and working, you know, to address these issues I've been talking about before. So then the second point, asymmetry. As far as asymmetry is concerned, I tend to be open to it, also based on what I've seen over the years. If, again, developing poor countries is in our interest, I think we should be prepared to accept at least temporarily asymmetric trade rules for a number of reasons. One mentioned already is that the notion of level playing field just works against the less developed. Very clear. Another one being that, also mentioned, in the medium to long term, we will also benefit from it. And a third thing, and that's more of a, let's say, a tactical consideration, it is a powerful way to include developing countries in common efforts to address global issues. So we have to, you know, to put something into the equation that is really attractive to these countries in order, you know, to make them agree with Copenhagen Agreement or whatever. And then a fourth point, which is kind of remote to this, but might also be addressed in that context, is that it might even help to tackle the issue of illicit financial flows. And that is an issue not much discussed and not much open, let's say, in the public domain, but it is really a scandal. The financial flows leaving the developing countries every year are bigger, much bigger, than official ODA flows going from rich countries to the poor. And in a way, and maybe that it's kind of a rude way of let's say, labeling it, but, you know, colonialism, in that sense, is not over. Is not over by mispricing raw material and whatever. So that's also something we have to look at, and I would like to see addressed in let's say, a new set of global rules. So although this is a very tricky field, I would be inclined to carefully investigate what is possible in this domain as part of Nancy's global social contract. So going back to the subject we are discussing this afternoon, save globalization from its cheerleaders, I have two remarks about the cheerleaders of globalization. First, you have those who define globalization as an exclusively economic phenomenon, as increasing volumes of international trade. And this brand of globalization has certainly made some positive contributions. But also, it was mentioned already this afternoon, exacerbated major problems in our world, like inequality and also some of the ecological issues. As such, I think this approach of globalization might quite well slow down in the coming years. And certainly, when we start basing our economies increasingly on natural cycles, because that will slow down, let's say, the fossil trade in fossils in the world. And if that happens, and that's a possible future, economies will become more localized than they maybe are today, and maybe also more regionalized, so more local production than we have today. So that is, you know, one brand of globalization. But then you also have those who approach globalization as really understanding the interconnectedness, the interdependency, and the common interests of all of us living on this planet. And this brand, in my view, is on the rise. In a way, time has brought somebody like Barack Obama, who almost physically is also, you know, a reflection of that, to the top. And in my view, this brand is rightly so on the rise, because we need it. Further increasing that understanding, that awareness, is the way to prepare the common ground and the common efforts necessary to effectively tackle the huge global issues we are facing. So looking at it in this way, I would say saving globalization is about bringing the right, that is the second brand of cheerleaders, to the fore. Thank you.